Good evening. My name is Andrew Zintek. I'm a landscape architect and a student here at the GSD. It is my great pleasure to introduce the third annual Margaret McCurry Lecture in the Design Arts, Vito Acconci, Into and Through and Out of Landscape. This lecture is organized by the student group, Land GSD, with support from the MDES program, Art, Design, and the Public Domain, the Dean's Office, and especially Brooke King. The lecture would not have been possible without support of Margaret McCurry, principal of the design firm Tigerman McCurry, Architects of Chicago. She can't be with us tonight, but we send our thanks. Vito has had a number of different labels attached to him over the years. Poet, artist, designer, architect, provocateur. That last one has probably stayed consistent. The other thing that has stayed consistent, and is the reason he is here to speak tonight of landscape, is an interest in space. Space between things, between words, between people. And an interest in the relations of public space and private space, and the people who occupy those places. Vito's work has been important to me as a young designer, trying to figure out my position within the discipline and profession of landscape architecture. So I'm very happy to welcome him here to Gund Hall. But first, one of our own professors, who has known Vito for quite some time, Christoph Edischko, is going to add a few thoughts. Thank you.
The problem with art, said Vito Acconci one time, is that there is no function. Protected in museums, fragile, as he said, it stays away from life. It does not connect, is ignorant about the complexity of human needs and of our experience. There is an expression from my old country. The escape to art is an escape from art. To bring art to life rather than life to art is to act against art for art's sake tradition. And this has been a choice, an ethical, political decision taken by some historical avant-garde artists. To fulfill this art to life agenda, many of them became designers and architects. By becoming designers, they could become useful, albeit on their own terms, inspirational, critical, interruptive, provocative, even transformative companions to human life. This has been a task in the design of the pre-avant-garde. This is my terminology. I don't think that it's acceptable, but that's how I call them. The avant-garde, the post-avant-garde artists as designers and designers as artists. Starting with Vito's favorite predecessors like Piranesi, Boulez, and early colleagues, like the Situationist International, designers, the Archigram, Fluxus, Holline, Pichler, Thiem, Lucien Kroll. I'm not sure if Vito would agree with putting his name here. But also with, no doubt, the younger generation, who learned a great deal from Vito, like Lucy Orta, Michael Rakowitz with his Parasite design, N55, the Urban Survival Collective, Preta Revolte, the Protest Support Designers Group, and many older and younger other artists, designers. Vito is a remarkable, prolific, persistent, and relentless figure and charismatic co-creator of this risk worth-taking and good troublemaking tradition. In Vito's word, architectural structures and forms of urban environment should function as a scaffolding for life, for imagination, perception, and experience. So architecture for him should not simply and solely focus on giving life or liveness to new built structures, but on inspiring and assisting us in becoming more alive, to re-wake us, inspire and mobilize our lives. He said, if you make a space that is turned inside out or turned on its side, maybe a person will start to think that the world isn't fixed as all. The notion of architecture is a notion of some kind of action, some kind of performance. Writing about space, Henri Lefebvre pointed out that the most important use value in our life is not so much space, but time. True lived through experience unfolds only through time. But time and lived through experience seem taken away, even stolen from us and used without permission or compensation, or time recompensation. Borders who employ us, organize and manage life in our cities, appropriate and administrate the public ways. To counter this, through his design, Vito Acconci creates conditions for us to recapture the taken away time and experience meaningful, honest, free, creative, dynamic, social, responsive, even interactive time. Another issue important for Vito is the status of design in the existing, in face of existing, already designed architecture and public space, a space that is built as fixed and stable. Mobile, portable, temporary structures, even transient monuments, might be considered as new designers' task to keep us alive as active subjects. And in this parasitical way, keeping also existing stable architecture alive and relevant. 15 years ago, in a conversation with Kenny Schlachtner and Ilion Pfaff in London, Acconci said, in order to stay alive, architecture has to have its own living system. The skin has to change. And it has to intertwine with the city in a way. Architecture should be some kind of parasite or virus. It should leach into other architecture, into the city that is already built. Kenny's reaction to this was straightforward. Well, this is not a way to make a lot of friends in the architectural community. Vito, I assure you, there is no longer such a danger here. This room is a living testimony to it. You have many friends here, perhaps a new vast generation of potential colleagues, a new breed of parasitical and viral designers who might join you in the field of de-design, destabilizing architecture, the unbuilding or building at the top of the buildings, creating new form and programs for responsive, performative, and action architecture. Art, design, and the public domain is one of among new programs at GSD, the direction of which owes a great deal to you, to your persistent practice, focus, and advocacy. Through this program and across all programs at GSD, we'll keep trying to launch new ideas and projects inspired by your powerful, provocative, honest, and meaningful work. So you are more than welcome here.
Thank you. Thank you. That's not so easy to live up to, but thank you. Okay, the talk tonight will be in three parts. The first part is an attempt to show how work started in one field, how it started in writing, started in poetry, and gradually became something else, became design. Work of mine started in the mid 60s. I thought of myself as a writer. What I was trying to do with words is maybe make words be what possibly they can't be. I wanted words to be matter. I wanted words to be material. when you see a word, you're used to seeing through a word to content, to subject matter. I wondered if maybe you could do something else at the same time. Could you stop at a word? So I wanted words to be as literal as possible, as factual as possible. When I think in order to see, I can still be heard now, right? Yeah, good. No, it's easier for me to see stuff here. I wanted words to be something like fact. It seemed impossible for me to write on the page a word like tree, a word like chair, because those words referred to another space, a space off the page, whereas I could use on the page words like here, there, at that time, in that place. In other words, words that directly refer to my act of writing on the page, your act, the reader's act of reading the page. So I wanted a poem to be about going from left margin to right margin, going from top to bottom. I particularly understood what Christoph said about time, because time, I think, is more important than space, especially in a virtual age. But the act of going through, the act of crossing a page, going down a page, the act of going through a space is more important than the image of a space. So I wanted to write things that were as literal as possible. A poem beginning with a period, then the rest of the poem plays on the word period. I have made my point. I make it again. Now you get the point. Or an attempt to make a poem that writes itself, starting with the phrase let it go, going to the dictionary, and then writing down every word in order after the word go until I reach the bottom of the page. The last piece of mine that I thought of as a poem, as a piece of writing, was a poem written in 1969. It consisted of a book on reading speed, how to improve reading speed, and the title I gave to it was something like the time taken for me to walk from such and such a block to such and such a corner. By the time I had gotten to that point, it seemed that I had started with limiting myself to the page. Now the page took me out into real space, so I couldn't turn back. I couldn't use the page anymore. I couldn't be a writer anymore. I had to do stuff in real space, in actual space, in physical space. One example, a piece done in 1969 for a program of pieces called Street Works, in which a number of people, some artists, some writers, were asked to do something over the period of a month on the street, on and in New York streets. And it was going to be shown for a month. I thought I didn't like the idea of showing. I wanted the idea of doing. So I wanted to do something that I could do every day for that month. Each day I would pick out at random a person in the street, a person walking. Each day then I would follow a different person until that person entered a private place, home, office. home office, whatever. So that following episodes ranged from, say, 2 or 3 minute episodes when someone might get into a taxi and I couldn't follow, ranging from that to, say, 7 or 8 hour episodes when someone might go to a restaurant, a movie, etc. Okay, with regard to the method I had set for myself, I would follow a person as long as I could until that person entered a private place. If a language could be applied to activities like this, the language might be something like, I, a person, an agent, attend to it, a world considered as if it's out there. I try to find some way to key myself into that world, tie myself into that world. After doing pieces like this for a while in 1969, I started to wonder, am I cheating? I'm using my own person in pieces, but am I making enough use of the personness of my person, the kind of, quote, self of my person. So in 1970, the movement of pieces started to change. Rather than I attend to it, a world considered as if it's out there, I start to attend to me. I concentrate on me. How do I prove, both to myself and others, that I'm concentrating on myself? One obvious way is to do something physical to myself. Apply some physical stress to my body. Now that physical stress is being applied to my body, maybe the body starts to adapt according to that stress. Maybe the body starts to change according to that stress. One example of film done in 1970-71 called Conversions. The first part of the film begins in darkness. There's a light moving around on the screen. The light is a candle that I'm moving around in front of my body. The candle is the light source for the film. As I move the candle near to my chest, the camera zooms in, and the rest of part one of the film is spent in me using the candle, the light source for the film, using the candle to burn the hair off each breast. Once the hair is removed, pulling at each breast in a kind of futile attempt to develop a woman's breast, hence the name of the film, Conversions. One or two things about the action. Obviously, there are easier ways to look like a woman, so which made it obvious to me that that's not what I was trying to do. What I was trying to do is doing something that was almost like the little engine that could. I wanted to do something that I couldn't do. It was a way to say, I think I can, until maybe I finally could. Remember, this was the time of so-called conceptual art, and I think I was trying to maybe apply the mind to the body, force the mind onto the body. After doing pieces like this for a while, I started to wonder, am I isolating? I just want one step back. One of the reasons I was doing pieces like this was that I wondered, what's the relation of a possible viewer to me? How can a viewer possibly enter my space? And I thought, maybe if I kind of break something in me, maybe if I do something that physically, not exactly tears me, but at least opens me, maybe now a viewer can enter my space. At least that's what I hoped I would do. I realized I was doing exactly the opposite. A viewer was always an outsider. The kind of action I was doing was making a closed circle around myself. I start an action, this action ends in me. The viewer is outside this kind of closed circle. The viewer is always a kind of voyeur, looking in on something that he or she isn't supposed to see. So I thought, I have to break out of this closed circle. I have to break out of this closed circle break out of this closed circle and find a way to approach you, the viewer, the visitor. This started to happen in 1971. This is a piece called Claim. It took place in a two-level space, street level and basement. As people come in on street level, there's a video monitor next to the door, that leads downstairs to the basement. The video monitor acts as a kind of warning to visitors, maybe an announcement to visitors, but maybe a kind of warning. Seeing what's on the video monitor, they decide whether or not to open the door, come downstairs. The piece is a three-hour piece. I'm seated on a chair at the foot of the stairs in the basement. I'm blindfolded. I have with me two lead pipes and a crowbar. I'm talking, constantly talking aloud to myself, saying things like, I'm alone here in the basement. I want to stay alone here in the basement. I don't want anybody to come down in the basement with me. I'll stop anybody from coming down in the basement with me. I'm alone here in the basement. In other words, using talk as a kind of self-hypnotizing device, trying to convince myself that this basement is mine. So whenever I hear somebody coming down the stairs, I swing the lead pipe, swing the crowbar in front of me, as the title of the piece says, claiming this space. Obviously, I didn't know at this time that eventually I would be doing something like design, something like architecture. In retrospect, this could be a kind of trying to make a kind of private house, you know, a private house that doesn't want anybody else in. Okay, what I liked about this piece was that it started to seem to me that I was finally setting up some kind of relation between person in the role of artist and person in the role of viewer. At the same time, what was bothering me about pieces like this was that I was on a still point. Viewers, visitors are being asked to go through lead pipes and crowbars in order to get to me. In other words, I thought, or I wanted to set up a kind of meeting between me and you, and I started to think, I'm setting myself up in this extra grandiose position. Viewers have to struggle in order to get to me. In other words, everything I thought I hated about art as a kind of religion, artwork as a kind of altar, artist as a kind of priest, it started to seem to me that my work was not only confirming but enhancing. So it seemed to me the problem was focus. One or two things about this piece. The reason for the blindfold was that I realized that if I'm facing people, I obviously couldn't swing the lead pipe, the crowbar. If they're abstract aggressors, I could. Therefore, I had to make them non-persons. I had to make them intruders, but not recognizable people. Okay. It seemed to me that the problem was focus. As soon as uh, as soon as people entered the space, I was this target. I was the focal point. I was this prime figure. And I hated that. I hated the notion of performance. I hated myself as a performer because this seemed like I was making, was I doing art or was I making a kind of personality cult? And I was afraid I was making a personality cult. So there had to be a way around that. There had to be a way around me being focused on. This started to happen, I think, in the beginning of 1972. A piece done in a gallery room that was approximately 25 feet wide, 45 or 50 feet long. The floor starts to rise in the middle of the room. The floor becomes a ramp that rises to a height of 2.5 feet, 3 feet at the far wall. The piece is done for a number of days. Each day from opening time of the gallery to closing time, so from 10 o'clock in the morning till 6, a person walks into the room because the floor is a ramp is a continuation of the floor. Person probably walks up the ramp across the ramp without thinking about it too much. I'm underneath the ramp. I'm underneath the floor, moving around under this space where people are walking, and my attempt is to constantly masturbate. In order to do so, I can use visitors' footsteps as help. I can build sexual fantasies on those footsteps. Those sexual fantasies can keep my activity going, keep my masturbation going. I forgot to mention a very important, at least for me, and I hope for people, an important part of the project. As people are walking up the ramp, there's a sound, there's a voice coming up from under the floor. It's my voice saying things like, I'm doing this with the person on my left, I'm touching your hair, I'm running my hand down your back. Every once in a while, the masturbation reaches climax. Maybe viewer on top of the floor, on top of the ramp, might be thinking something like, oh, he's done this with me, he's done this for me. In any case, an attempt to join more private space under the floor with more social space, more public space on top of the floor. I had mentioned that the piece was done from 10 o'clock in the morning to 6, opening time of the gallery to closing time. I mentioned that not so much to stress the endurance test quality of the project, though probably, like it or not, it became that. What was important to me about the 10 o'clock to 6 is that it seemed important that nobody was there when I entered in the morning. No one was there when I left at night. In other words, for me, what I wanted the project to do was, could I become part of the room? Could I become part of the architecture of the room? Could I become part of the floor? Okay. After doing seedbed, I had a number of second thoughts. One of the second thoughts was, if I wasn't seen at all, did I actually have to be there? In other words, I was having a lot of doubts and hesitations. About live presence in a piece. And I should mention a little bit about that live presence. single-person activity was something that a number of people were doing at that time, and people were doing it everywhere. There were people in New York, there were people in San Francisco, people in Holland, people in Germany, because this was a time in which the common language of the time was finding oneself. Concentrate on the self, find oneself. Concentrate so much on the self that maybe you become separate from others. So I think what I was doing and what a number of people in an art context were doing at the end of the 60s, beginning of the 70s, was the same kind of thing that that musicians were doing. Neil Young, Van Morrison, long song, 7-minute song, 9-minute song, single voice, usually male voice, single voice with all the time in the world to find the self. When I said before that I was starting to have second thoughts, the second thoughts came from the fact that it wasn't the late 60s anymore. It was 1972, 1973, 74. In other words, people were starting to think very differently about the self, about person. Maybe self didn't exist. Maybe if you withdraw in order to find the self, you find nothing. I think we're starting to think maybe the self exists only as part of a social system, a cultural system, a political system. So by 73, 74, a lot of people who had been doing performance started to do what curators and critics started to call installations. There have been a lot of very vague terms in art. Installation is very possibly the vaguest. Anything is installed. A painting is installed. A rug is installed. A table is installed. Therefore, those of us who were doing what other people were calling installation, I think we're desperate to think, why are we doing this? And what was important to me about so-called installation was that at that time, I tried not to have an idea for a piece until I was given a place to show the piece. In other words, I wanted the piece to be specific to a particular showing place. Why? Because I despise the act. I despise the tendency to think of art as a kind of universal thing. I didn't believe in universals. I didn't want to believe in universals. I was always very impressed by this Bertolt Brecht poem where he said, even if it was proven to me that God existed, I wouldn't believe it because I'm freer if God doesn't exist. And I felt kind of the same way about universals. So I wanted whatever I was doing to be specific to the place I was doing it in. The other thing that was important to me about installations was that obviously there were going to be people in the gallery, in the museum. I wanted people to be part of the piece, to be part of the installation. Okay, one example, a 1976 piece called Where We Are Now, parentheses, who are we anyway? This room at the right of the slide is the main room in the gallery. For the purpose of this show, of this piece, the doorway is blocked off. The outside of the room painted black. Next to the black room is a long table, long wooden plank. Stools on either side of the table. The table is propped up on the windowsill of the gallery, and then extends out the window. So what began as a table becomes a diving board. There's a hanging speaker above the table. There's constant sound. There's a constant clock ticking. My voice comes in saying things like, now that we're all here together, and what do you think, Bob? Now that we've gone as far as we can go, and what do you think, Barbara? Now that we're satisfied, etc. Okay, for me it was an attempt to, try to turn a gallery or museum space into a more public place, into a community meeting place. And I thought maybe this piece started to do that. At the same time, I thought, I'm kidding myself. A gallery or museum is never going to be a real public place. If I really thought my work needed a public place, I'd better find some way to get there. So at the end of the 70s, beginning of the 80s, I started to orient my stuff towards possible public places. I knew there were people that already dealt with public places. There were architects, maybe industrial designers, maybe landscape architects. So I had to start trying to develop a way to do a kind of architecture. Stuff of mine had always been connected with person's body. So in the beginning of the 80s, I tried to design pieces that could be not just used by people, but almost formed by people. This is a 1980 piece called Instant House. Four panels, United States flag covered on the ground. There's a swing in the middle. If a person sits on the swing starts to go down and the panels start to rise up. And the panels are United States flag inside, Soviet flag house outside. So you make one kind of space for, as you're using it, you make one kind of space for you, another kind of space as an announcement for others. One thing I liked about pieces like this was that the house only lasted as long as you kept the instrument going. Once you got up off the swing, the panels went down to their original position. Though I liked that, I started to think, this isn't house enough. House is something, building is something that you have to be able to go back to. So by the mid-80s, I was trying to make something more like a house. This was a 1984 piece called Bad Dream House. The title probably came from the fact that an architect might make a dream house. I'm not a real architect, so all I can do is make a bad dream house. So three upside down houses, two upside down houses on the ground, tilted against each other so that they support a third upside down house on top. The houses on the ground, like houses you expect to find on the ground, conventional brick facing shingled roof. They cradle in between them a kind of glass house, garden house. You walk into the open gable. You sit at or walk past an upside down table. You go upstairs to what used to be the underside of the house. Now that it's upside down, it becomes facing sets of seats or bleachers. Or you could go further upstairs to the glass house. Some walls transparent, some walls mirrored, some walls opaque. Okay, around that time, the mid-80s, I started to think if the pieces I'm designing make their own housing, maybe I don't need a gallery. Maybe I don't need a museum. So by the end of the 80s, I thought I have to change my way of working. I can't be a single agent anymore, for two basic reasons. I wanted to do architecture, but I really didn't know how to do architecture. So I needed to work with people who didn't know how. I had to work with architects. I had to work with people who were at least learning to be architects. But there was also another reason why I thought I had to work with other people. I started to be convinced that I started to be very, very, very concerned with, maybe overly obsessed with, English language phrases like "the person who lives by the sword dies by the sword," which I translated into, "if something begins private, it probably ends private." So I thought the only way for something to be public is that it has to begin at least semi-public. And public probably begins with the number three. One is a solo, two is a couple or a mirror image, the third person starts an argument, and public probably starts when an argument starts. So by the end of the 80s, Acconci Studio started. It exists now. Now it's a little bigger, but not that much bigger. There were five designers in the studio, plus me. The way Acconci Studio doesn't work is I have an idea for a project and everybody else carries it out. It's more of a kind of discussion group. It's a number of people forming pieces together, talking together. It's been remarked by people that this is much noisier than most architect studios. We have music on a lot. We have music on a lot because I'm convinced that the music of a time is the way to maybe learn what the time is. So yes, in the beginning, in the late 60s, I was listening to single person music, Neil Young, etc. But in retrospect, and even at that time, that kind of music seemed like country music. It was like a person with all the time in the world trying to find himself or herself. But at the same time, there was another kind of music. There was the Velvet Underground, which was the total opposite. Here was the introduction of the city, a music that was dense, that was crowded. By the mid-70s, the music I was listening to was the Ramones, the Sex Pistols. No longer single voice, it seemed like a group voice. No longer long songs, because a shout couldn't be sustained for more than a minute and a half or two minutes. So when I was doing installations, the kind of stuff I was listening to was this kind of almost like group voice, a voice almost shouting at the listeners. You know, that the piece I mentioned, this voice is as if it's driving a listener up against the wall. You know, now that we're all here together, what do you think? Now that we've gone as far as we can go, what do you think? With the hope, though I don't know if this hope could ever be reached, this hope could ever be fulfilled, with the hope that if a person is intruded upon enough, if a person is pushed up against the wall, maybe a person starts to think, wait a minute, I don't have to take this. Now, I have no idea if pieces work that way. I suspect they didn't. So a group of people working together. As I said, Acconci Studio was formed in 1988. In the 90s, obviously no one knew us as architects. I did have a reputation. I did have some kind of reputation in art. So what we were asked to do were most often or almost solely not architecture projects, but so-called public art projects. public art exists because of 1% for art laws. When a public building is built, 1% of the budget is allotted to art. I tried to believe in the beginning that maybe this made sense for us. If you do a so-called public art piece, if you do a public art project, maybe you're not paid as much attention to as the architect is. So maybe you can come in from the margins. Maybe you can be a kind of minority voice. One or two examples of public art projects. The site of a project we did in 1995 at Queens College in New York. The site was the English Department building. At either side of the stairway, there's a pedestal on top of which is a 3-foot diameter concrete sphere. So those concrete spheres were our starting point. The spheres seemed as if they were trying to make an extra grandiose entrance to what was only the entrance to an English Department building. At the same time, these spheres seemed kind of lonely inside this space. So what our project consisted of was to include other spheres so that the existing spheres became part of this field of spheres, ranging from very small, 1 foot in diameter, going through the existing 3-foot diameter sphere, going to a sphere 12 feet in diameter, 15 feet in diameter. You could walk through the spheres. Possibly sit inside a sphere. As it became night, the interior of the spheres became lit. So maybe this space, which was in the beginning maybe a kind of pass-through space, became more of a kind of meeting place. Another example of a public art project was a project we did in 1998 at the Philadelphia airport. We were asked to do something at the end of the ground floor of a building. This was the end of the building, so our starting point was the floors had nowhere to go here. So all the floors could do is to rise up. Terrazzo floor rises up, folds over itself, so you can sit inside. Here, terrazzo floor goes up to the mezzanine. Here, carpeted floor from the mezzanine comes down. As the floors rise, they're replaced with planting. Here, floor from below goes upstairs. After doing public art projects for a while, and again, the way we started was, I wanted to have this conviction that maybe there's an advantage in doing public art. You're not noticed as much. Maybe you can be the minority voice. But after a while, I started to think 1% for art laws means that the art is worth 1% of the architecture, so that probably public art can never be more than a folly. Okay. The next part of the talk is I want to go through some of the projects we've done in the last maybe ten years or so. Starting with something close to the body, and then going further and further out from the body. So I think the first architecture is clothing, the way the skin covers the bones. Then clothing can cover the skin and bones. I want to show some projects that might not necessarily be finished, projects that we want to keep working on. This was This project was done in response to a request by a little fashion magazine in New York called The Black Box, who proposed to us that the umbrella hasn't been redesigned in years, so could we try our hand at a new umbrella? So we started with the idea of ruffles in clothing, thinking that our umbrella could fold down and ruffles, this kind of pleating system, folding system, would be the means of doing that. So we would make something called an umbruffla, a combination of an umbrella and ruffles. It would be made of a two-way mirrored material, so that when you're wearing it, you could see out, but from outside, people could probably just see the reflections of the city. It has some differences from the conventional umbrella. You can tie one end to your waist, one end to your wrist, so your hands are free. You can wrap it around you as a kind of shawl. There could be openings between the ruffles so that you could avoid the wind problem. It's easier to have another person in with you under this umbrella. Some other notions of clothing. We would love to try to do an idea of clothing based on the notion of a magnetic field, an electric field, repellents and attractions, and attractors. Say you pick 5 points on the body: two nipples, a navel, a vagina or a penis, and an asshole. Now, can you connect? Can some of these points repel or attract the others? And in so doing, can you make something that's so crowded with fibers, with thread, that it becomes a kind of clothing? This is something we haven't done, but we'd love to try it. But in order to try it, it seems like you would have to have the nipples and vaginas, et cetera, moving so that they would change whether they're attracting or repelling. Don't quite know how to do that. This is a kind of a theoretical project we tried to work on this past summer, something that we called a two-way skin suit. There would be these pieces of clothing flying around in the air. You pull one down, and now when you put it on, you have this kind of field of fibers that goes out from your body. The fibers can take things in and eliminate things. You can eliminate waste through these fibers. You can start to contact another person by means of these fibers. Okay, starting from clothing, then the next step away from the body is utensils or appliances, products. A few years ago, in 2004 or so, Alessi, the Italian design company, approached a number of designers, and we were asked to do a coffee tea set. What Alessi wanted was four containers for coffee, tea, milk, and sugar, and a tray. We thought if we did something that cohered enough, it wouldn't need a tray. So we started with a generalized sphere, took away parts of the sphere until all that was left was four containers: coffee, tea, milk, and sugar, and these transparent connectors. We thought something Alessi left out was, what about cups? What about means by which you could drink these liquids? So the way our coffee tea set would be used is that the transparent connectors were places for cups and saucers, so you could take the cups and saucers out. This spheroid has four flat points. So you roll it to one flat point. Now it's stable. You insert a cup, raise the cup up, and now coffee comes out or tea comes out. Roll it to another flat point. You can get another flat spot. You can get milk and sugar, etc. The next step out from the body after products would be seeding. This was an attempt we made in 2000, 2001 to make outdoor seeding modeled on a Möbius strip. So the way a Möbius strip by twisting has what seems to be an outside and an inside. The back of our seat twists to become the seat itself, twists to become the bottom of the seat. You can be sitting on the outside of the circle. You move over a little bit. You're inside the circle. Notions of seating are on our mind a lot, though we haven't aside from that Möbius bench, we haven't really finished anything. We like things to have double functions. So one thing we want to try is if we use these strips of felt would be firm enough that the ends of the strips could support a body. At the same time, they can be separate one from the other, so you can store things inside. Or maybe there could be a furniture unit that's full of holes. Some of the holes would be shelves. Some of the holes would be places for a user. The next step up is interiors. This is a clothing store we did in 2003 in Tokyo. For a group of young designers named United Bamboo. We wanted to do a clothing store that was as soft as skin. So the material we use is PVC, something like fabric. PVC is usually used for projection screen, rear screen projection. So we have PVC on the ceiling. We bring it down to make walls, bring it out to make a counter. The system is a push-pull system. You attach the PVC to the wall, pull it out as taut as possible, support it with a steel frame. So now it can support products. Since PVC is usually used for rear screen projection, we don't have to have lights from the outside. We can have lights within. It's a very small space for the store. It's about 15 feet at its widest point, 45 feet at its longest point. So we knew that we had to use all the extra space we could possibly get. Anytime there was a non-structural wall, we took the wall out and made this curving glass alcove outside the store. So we had now more room for hanging clothes. This is the outside of the store. The building that the United Bamboo people were given for their first store was a modular system that's usually used in Japan for houses, for residences. The United Bamboo people thought this was never going to look like a store. So we tried in a simple and relatively cheap way to cover the outside of the store with steel mesh, and then had a kind of perspective system from the back of the store to the front. In between the steel mesh are these bulging facades. The clothing store is on the ground floor, office space above. On the on the bulging facade of the upper floor, there's a projection screen. And the way it works is when you're inside the store, if you're trying on clothes, if you like the way you look, you can press a button on the mirror and you become the model for the United Bamboo clothes. We kind of got that idea from teenage schoolgirls in Tokyo who do very different and strange things with their socks. You know, they might be all the same, but they start to look very different. Okay, the next step away from the body is buildings, housing. This is a project we were asked to do. It didn't happen. Most of our projects don't happen. We probably build, I don't know, maybe 12% of our projects. At one point, I remember Rem Koolhaas telling me that he only built 12% of his projects, but I think that's changed. We were asked to do a house in Athens in Greece by two Greek brothers who wanted to have a house for both of them. When I went to see the site, it was the first time I had been to Greece, and I was struck by the extensive balcony life in Greece. So we proposed a house of two intersecting spirals, so that the roof of one brother's house became the balcony of the other brother's house, and vice versa. Another example of a building, and both of these, what I haven't brought up enough yet is that, yeah, we do spaces to be in, but I think our model is landscape and the time it takes to traverse landscape just as much as our model is a building. We tend to want buildings that become something like landscape, and maybe landscape that becomes something like buildings. This was in response to a competition for a library in Guadalajara in Mexico. What we proposed was that our library would start by stepping down into the ground, making this kind of plaza. Now that we went down, we start to step up. As the library steps up, it also steps out. There's a highway next to the library. So what we proposed was that was a library that could step over the highway, go to the rest of the city. Our starting point was that books are dangerous, so the library should go away from home. This could be a series of tentacles going into the city. Did we really think this could be accepted? We're kind of incurable optimists. I don't know if we think that it could be accepted, but we're not so sure that it would definitely be rejected. Going further out from buildings, going to the streets, to city streets. A few years ago, New York City held a competition for a new light system. The competition brief suggested that the new light post had to hold a number of different kinds of signs and different kinds of lights. So it should be a very thick light post. Sometimes we start a competition by maybe questioning what's been specified. We thought maybe all those different lights and all those different signs would never have to be used on every one occasion. So we thought, let's try to do the opposite. instead of the thickest post, let's do the thinnest possible post. Each thin post would hold one kind of light, one kind of sign. So if we needed more than one, we could braid them together, braid the thin posts together so that they could have multiple lights, multiple signs. Another example of not so much street furniture, but street building, are subway stations. This was the old subway station in Coney Island in New York. We were asked to provide a new facade for the station, and the facade we provided took as its model the nearby ocean. Just as the ocean is in waves, maybe our facade could wave from upper story to lower story. Our facade would wave and bulge. It would bulge in and then bulge out. It reaches a breaking point, so now it makes a place to view from. Sometimes the windows are narrower, sometimes wider. It was specified that since this station was at Coney Island, we had to have views. Sometimes the facade doesn't reach a breaking point. When it doesn't reach a breaking point, it becomes seating, so you can sit within the facade or in the extension of the facade out from the wall. Okay, next step is from city streets to the outlands of the city, maybe places for parks, places for outlands. This is a skate park we were asked to propose for San Juan in Puerto Rico. When we went to see the site, we saw that there were already high points on the site. So we thought maybe we should act as if the skate park is already there. All we had to do was join the high points. It was important for us that our skate park could be used at any time of night. So when there wasn't light, there would be artificial light. The first high point was a pedestrian bridge over a restaurant. So that became a place for these snake runs of skating ramp on either side of the pedestrian bridge. Our aim was to try not to separate skateboarders from pedestrians, so skateboarders would walk between pedestrians would walk between skateboarders. Skateboarders would be jumping above pedestrians, probably not as high as this. But this was maybe one of our first drawings. The second high point was a cone-shaped hill, so the ramps, the snake run of ramps from the last image now go towards the cone-shaped hill. Instead of going over the hill, they go inside the hill. It's a person-made hill, so the cone is hollow. So the bowls of our skating park are in the inside of the hill. The third high point is this slope. The ramps now step up the slope, making what skateboarders call street elements. The last high point is this plateau at the top of the slope. So at the top of the slope, the ramps make quarter pipes and half pipes above the ocean. This was one of those projects that every architect has, every designer has. It was definitely going to be built, but is not built. Same category of kind of the outlands of a city. This is the River Mur in Graz in Austria, where we were asked to use the river to make what they called a person-made island. And the person-made island should have three functions: a theater, a cafe, and the playground. So we started with a kind of conventional idea for a theater, a bowl. What if we turned that bowl upside down? What if we twisted that bowl? The bowl now becomes a dome. The twisting shape from bowl to dome and vice versa becomes the playground. The so-called island is lit at night. Light shines up from the seats of the theater. Light shines down from the roof of the cafe. This is the theater space. The bowl is starting to change into a kind of dome. We knew that this theater wouldn't always be used officially as a theater, so we wanted our seats to have a use even when there wasn't a stage event. Therefore, we designed the seats in waves so that it could be something like person-to-person seating, face-to-face seating, when it wasn't a theater. This is the space changing from dome to bowl. The playground elements are part of the structure, and it's almost impossible to separate the structure from the playground. Here are people entering the dome, the cafe. As you enter, there's a canopy that stretches down to make lounge seating around the dome. There's also portable seating, stackable seating. Again, it seems that landscape is on our mind a lot. We had to design a bar, so we designed the bar that had three bar counters. Why three bar counters? Because we thought that somebody is inevitably going to be drunk. That person who's drunk can't really see. But since there are three bar counters, no matter where the person extends his or her hand, the glass probably hits one of the bar counters. Okay, the last part of the talk is going over stuff, but different stuff of the last few years. Of the last maybe 8 years, ten years, we tend to think in terms of what we call operations that are made on a site, on a situation. This possibly comes from at least partially from my background in activity and performance. Our tendency is to make places that aren't so much nodes and stopping places, but are more activity places. We think more of circulation routes of movement than we do of modes of nodes. So I'm going to skip around with some of these operations. Operation number four: continuous surface, endless space. We were asked to do a playground in 2001, and we used this topological figure, a Klein bottle, as a place for a playground. We would have a Klein bottle with four necks. We always want choices so people could enter at any of these necks. We thought this was an appropriate model for a playground, because if we made the surface transparent, and if we filled it with holes, if we perforated it, then children climbing outside could come face to face with children climbing inside. You could slide from inside to outside, and vice versa. Operation number one: make a world, then poke a hole in the world. An architecture of holes. Like a lot of people, we made a kind of hypothetical proposal at the end of 2001, beginning of 2002. We made a hypothetical proposal for a new World Trade Center in New York. We proposed a World Trade Center full of holes, riddled with holes. Our premise was that if a building nowadays is going to be exploded anyway, maybe a building nowadays should come already exploded, pre-exploded. So we took the original site of the World Trade Center, extruded it to a height of 110 stories high. So there's more private office space than anybody could possibly need. So we would shoot cones through it. Shooting the cones through it resulted in riddling it with holes. Now it can act as a kind of urban camouflage. A terrorist possibly flying by above could look down and say, we don't have to worry about this building. We don't have to bother about this building. It's already been dealt with. Now that the building is riddled with holes, these holes become tunnels from outside to inside and vice versa. So now the rest of the city can come inside the building. Parks can come inside the building. Street vendors could come inside the building. In other words, instead of observing the convention that in order for a building to be built a few stories higher, it has to have a so-called public space outside, our urge is maybe single-minded spaces are never enough. Maybe each space needs its opposite. Maybe a public space needs the insertion of a private space, and vice versa, so that the system could possibly keep alive. This is an elevator shaft from office to office. This is a waterfall. This is a waterfall from park to park. Operation number seven: split, separate, strips and strands. This is a somewhat older project. In the mid 90s, the site was this kind of hill. So what we thought we would do in order to make spaces is move places from the hill, so now you have these in between places. We move part of the mound out, so now we have kind of store spaces inside. We move the mound out, now we have a kind of public space inside. We move a layer of grass out, so now there's a Now there's a kind of building underneath. We make playground spaces by raising trees, and now playground spaces are below. This gives more of an idea of the playground. Another example of the kind of split space is a project we did in The Hague in Holland. The site is a university with a kind of garden outside. Like a lot of cities in Holland, it's surrounded by water. But it's very difficult to go from the land to the water. The land is at least 3 or 4 meters above the water. So what we designed and built was, we would take this triangle and cut a triangle out of the triangle, so that now the triangle that's cut is shifted out into the water. As it shifted out into the water, it also shifts from up to down. So now it's like a kind of beach. You can step down. You can step down towards the water. When the displaced land is separated from the mainland, it kind of displaces parts. A circle is taken from the mainland, and it becomes a kind of island in the middle, so you can walk across. It's very difficult in public space to have private spaces. Private spaces mean crime spaces. But we try to have a space that is not hidden, but you can step down, you can become closer to the water, and maybe at least have a kind of semi-private space. Another example of splitting and strips and stands. Another project that seems as if it was definitely going to be built, but it's not. The site is in Norway in a city called Stavanger. A concert hall was designed, and an amphitheater was designed opposite the concert hall. Then the people who organized this said that they were afraid that this wasn't going to be used enough. Could it be used when it wasn't being used for concerts? Could it become a kind of interpersonal space? So what we proposed, and again, it was supposed to be built, but won't. What we proposed was a system of rivers and rivulets that we would send down the steps and seats, so it would cut through the steps and seats. So you could still face forward, face straight ahead, but now you could have face-to-face seating, person-to-person seating. Operation number 8, folding, enfolding, embedding. A project we proposed, we were asked to propose for a very small village in the south of France, Beaumont. It's a village of 400 people. We most often get projects for cities, so this was a kind of rare occasion for us. Beaumont is in the mountains. It exists on slopes. Their major industry is farming, but because it exists on a mountainside, the only way farming can exist is if the slopes are terraced. So we thought maybe we could use that notion of terracing for houses. We could have houses that exist partially on the top of the slope, partially inside the slope. So the houses would be warmer in winter, cooler in summer. So there would be these kinds of bumps that would be housing. folding, embedding. A project we were asked to do or asked to compete for in a city in Russia, Perm. The project was for a museum in Perm. The museum was going to be at the top of this slope. Our starting point was that maybe the slope was too strong. Maybe the museum couldn't resist the slope. So the museum starts at the top of the hill where it's supposed to be, but now starts to go down the hill. It goes under a bridge. It goes over train tracks. Perm is a kind of out of the way place. So we thought the museum could double as a train station. So you could take the railroad directly to the museum. The museum then would go down into the water. I want to try to go maybe quickly over some of these other operations. Operation number 9, swirl, swoon, a project we're working on now for a city in Holland, a very small city called Os. This site is filled with five burial mounds, and what people want there is what they're calling a meditation park. So each mound would be the source of a spiral that goes down into the ground. The spirals are close one to the other, so they would be places where one spiral would intermix with another spiral. We thought the spirals would make these places where people could meander, where people could meditate. We've tried this kind of swoon and spiral notion with a temporary lobby we did recently for the Bronx Museum in New York. Lost track. Sorry. Operation number 12, adapt, change, modify, a chameleon architecture. This is a landscape project that was done in Munich in 2000. The site was a high office tower and a kind of park space, garden space below. So what we wanted to do was try to use both the highs and the lows of the space. On top of the tower is a wind wheel, a wind turbine. The wind turbine produces electricity. Below in the ground, a circle of land is on a turntable below the ground. the turntable moves by motors that are powered by the wind turbine, so that this circle of landscape is always moving. So if you're standing inside the building and you see a tree that's here, you turn away for a while, you come back, the tree is now there, because the thing is constantly moving. The notion of movement and change is important. This is a project we're working on now in the north of France. The site is a large fishing port. They claim it's the largest fishing port in Europe. One thing they wanted us to do was a park. We thought that a park at the ocean should be different than a park in dry land. So what we've proposed is that we would have a pipe system bringing water in under the land. The tide here changes. The tide here changes 30 feet each day. So the changing tide now raises and lowers furniture of the park. Here the tide is low tide, so the amphitheater goes inside the ground. Here it's mid tide, so there's no amphitheater. Here it's high tide, so the amphitheater is pushed up by the rising tide. Change is probably the most important thing for us. This is a proposal we made for an ideas competition in Strasbourg, in France. We wanted to make a plaza that would never be the same. So there would be an arc system. The arc system would double as a lighting system. The arc system carries canopies. These canopies could always be changed. There are these little pavilions that are attached to these columns, so that they fan out. There's a kind of track system so that all the furniture could be changed. You can move chair next to chair, move tables together. We've tried to do a car that was a total failure, but we wanted to do a car that didn't need tires. It would work according to a science, or maybe a pseudoscience, called cymatics, which is the insertion of sound onto planes. So the insertion of sound makes the planes ripple. So we thought if we had multiple planes, the rippling would cause motion. We were working with an MIT scientist who said he's proven that this could go 15 miles per hour, but we thought this isn't science fiction, it's fantasy. So we kind of dropped it. Some things we would love to continue. The idea of airbags and putting them on the outside of the car, so that instead of resisting impact, you could bend and yield with impact. In the future, maybe not everybody has to drive. So cars are plugged together. One person drives, everybody else falls asleep. Let's try to get towards the end. Notions of growth and emergence are important for us. This is something we're working on now for a Swiss transport museum in Luzerne. They asked us to do a canopy system for their courtyard, but then complicated it kind of interestingly, because they said they had to lend their canopy to other institutions. When we have more to do, I think we we possibly do better projects. We could now include a car as part of our project. Stored in the trunk of the car would be an inflatable. When you open the trunk, this inflatable would fan out and make a kind of amphitheater system. Could be attached to the Swiss Transport Museum is five different buildings: a building of cars, a building of boats, etc. In their courtyard are airplanes. So these inflatables that make the canopy can be tied into the airplanes in the courtyard. This is a project we're working on now in Indianapolis, in the United States. It's a tunnel through a building. The tunnel would be a different color light at different times of the day. As you walk through it, as you tunnel through it, there's a kind of mesh system above your head and at your sides. And it holds thousands of LED lights. There are LED lights in the pavement. So as you walk, as you cycle through, you activate a sensor that releases this kind of swarm of fireflies around you. As you come upon another person, your fireflies start to mix with another person's fireflies. Let's kind of skip a little bit. The most recent projects have been attempts to be kind of airier. Operation number 18, an architecture of air. A proposal we made for a pavilion in an art fair in Miami. The roofs of the pavilion would be held by balloons. A proposal we made for a solar park in Buffalo. We work with consultants a lot. A consultant we call infrequently is a robotics engineer named Paul Bartlett, because we were a little puzzled that the University of Buffalo had been given this gift of old solar panels, and they were very opaque. So we thought these were just going to make shadows on the land. Our robotics engineer suggested that we could use something like a fiber optic system. By making tiny holes in these opaque panels, we could have something like fiber optics. The sky could come down in pixels through these holes and onto pools, so that there would be the sky below just as there's sky above. This is a project that was just rejected 3 days ago. A proposal we made for Winnipeg in Canada. We were in this competition in this limited competition where they wanted a kind of wall of water. We thought a wall of water was something that was maybe too totally visual. So we tried to make these little capsules surrounded by waterfalls, so that you would kind of slip in and go into one, then you can slip into another and to another. Here's a person slipping into one capsule of water here, another capsule of water there. Last operation is an architecture of pixels and of bits and pixels, of grains and particles. A few months ago, or this past year, the Guggenheim Museum in New York asked a number of designers and artists to propose a new Guggenheim. It wasn't going to be built. What they asked was for they called a show that they were going to do contemplating the void. So our starting point was that it's possibly difficult to walk on the ramp of the Guggenheim in New York without thinking that maybe you won't die if you throw yourself off the edge, you know, that this space is probably so great that maybe you could even fly. Now, that's probably not true, but we tried to propose this space filled with something like spider webs or rubber bands, so that you could go over the railing and step into this mass of rubber bands, so that it could turn into a gym for you. Okay, some of the recent projects is trying to extend that kind of fiber idea. A project that's supposed to be built soon in a small city called Ichihara in Japan. A new museum was built. We weren't asked to build a museum, but we were asked to, could we do a stairway system and a ramp system? So we're trying to make this system out of fibers, so that light could come through. You could sit on the edges of fibers. A project that might happen soon, but of course, things might always happen soon until it gets close to when they're happening, and then they don't. This is for a plaza in Santiago in Chile. It's a plaza called Plaza Italia, where people spend a lot of time grouping, whether it's before or after a soccer game, or whether it's for a political demonstration. And they asked us that could we enlarge the plaza? And we thought maybe we could have a plaza underneath the plaza, so that again it would be filled with these kinds of fibers. I think more important now is thinking that we've been convinced lately that maybe a plaza is too large for people to self-organize. If a plaza is so large, it needs some kind of leader. So what we try to do is make these kinds of smaller spaces, break the space up into smaller places for maybe three to five people, seven to nine people, so that people, because if so few people are together, you don't have to ask each other's permission to talk, so that maybe you can be self-organizing. So people in one, a person in one capsule now can maybe go to another capsule. So the cast of characters always changes, and maybe some kind of political action could possibly start from the ground up. It's kind of significant that maybe you don't need capsule spaces. Maybe all you need is a cell phone and Facebook, since that's the real public space. I would hate to give up some kind of physical public space. I still hope there can be a reason for a mix of the virtual and the physical. Okay. That gives some idea, or maybe too much of an idea, of how stuff went from poetry to this, poetry to design. Maybe we should turn on the lights and see if anybody wants to talk.
So obviously, we're well beyond an hour, but if anyone has a couple questions, please feel free.
No questions. Okay. Probably. Yeah, please.
Thank you so much for your presentation. Thank you so much. It's immensely inspiring to hear you talk. And I mean, we've known about you for a long time, and you're a celebrity. And it's just so exciting to hear all these ideas. Like, it seems like even though you talk about projects being rejected, you just keep coming up with ideas that at first sound crazy.
I hope they're not so crazy. You know,
yeah,
I hope that
the
if we carry them through, maybe there's some way they can be done.
Right.
So, and, as was mentioned, as I think Christoph mentioned, that the stuff that I've been most influenced by is probably architecture that hasn't been built. You know, Boulay and Piranesi in the 18th century. Archegram in the 60s. I don't think unbuilt architecture is enough. I think sometimes it's easier to be influenced by unbuilt architecture because it's easier, much as I want to talk against picture, it's easier to understand something when it's a picture. It's harder to understand something when you're in the middle of it. But I think it's important to build because I think it's important that people experience the thing rather than just study it. It's easier to study something if it's in front of you, but it's probably harder. It's impossible to experience if it's in front of you.
And another thing I was wondering about was what you mentioned near the end of your talk about Facebook. And
yeah.
Twitter, you know, do you think that there's some parallel between physical space and kind of the internet?
Yeah, I think those kinds of little cluster spaces we've been trying to do is a physical version of possibly what can be done better virtually. I don't know. I don't know how to totally resort to a virtual space. I come from maybe too much older generation. I still want some mix. No, I always I don't. But I know I have to. And I will break down. Do you use Facebook? Yeah? You do? But what?
Very little.
Very little? Yeah.
But people do like operating this equipment in physical public space.
I think that if it's built enough so that they can use it.
I have a question kind of going off of that.
Yeah.
With all of your work done in the past about how, like, people interact with each other and the idea of space, and now with technology being such a large part of our lives, people are really, like, zeroed in on themselves. Do you have any, like, thoughts about maybe pushing people together through architecture and maybe creating that awkwardness that you created in, like, your following piece or something beyond those lines that's more psychological?
No, I mean, I was kind of convinced that a lot of virtual technology leads to privacy, but that's obviously not true of what's happened in Egypt, what's happening now in Libya. It's obviously causing a kind of I don't know if it's causing, but it's certainly aiding the possibility of a revolution.
I agree, like, on, like, the broad scheme of things. Like, obviously, like, we're channeling information all over the world. But when it comes down to conversation and being on a bench with someone, sitting next to someone, like, the interactions that go on between them.
Yeah. I mean, I admit, I thought an interactive space is an important thing to have. I'm not so sure anymore. I'm not so sure that... You know, can you interact with somebody when you don't interact at all? Can you do it quicker, and can you interact with more people if you just do it virtually? Is it enough? I don't know. You know, I'm not sure. Does your question imply you think?
I
the physical has to be there. There is, but what if they're mixed? And I don't know. I mean, things can be faster if they're virtual. I mean, I'm starting to think that, you know, I don't know if there's anything wrong with, I mean, in the same way that that I don't think people can be fully human anymore. They have to be human and partially robotic. And that's probably an advantage, you know. It's probably better to have a third arm, and one that and one that doesn't hurt, you know. That so using that as a model, I wonder about virtual. Maybe I don't know if it can be totally enough, but obviously I don't know how to answer the question.
Yeah. You have a microphone.
Yes. I know, and I couldn't have without it. Nobody could hear a word I say.
I have another question.
Please.
I think one of the appeals of socializing online is that you can create an avatar of a fantasy of who you can be. It's like immediate gratification of becoming another. And I was wondering if you had thoughts on how architecture might be able to do that as well.
Mm.
Or I guess like Facebook offers you to create a filter of who you are.
Yeah, yeah.
And I think that's something that's really
but is that, I don't know how it's, I don't know, can you, I mean, I'd love to believe that you can put on a new person the way you change clothes, but I don't know if that's really true. You know, I guess you can.
In my studio project right now, I've been trying to design a building that maybe filters your best body parts and exhibits them through different apertures, but I was just wondering if you ever considered this.
No, I don't have any good body parts anymore. You know, I never did, but now I know. Now I know I don't. You know, I don't know. I mean, shouldn't there be a way to use avatars or social media as something that's maybe larger than an individual person, or is it just a way to distribute and publicize an individual person?
I think it can tell a collective story, or it gives you a sense of collectively what 16-year-olds are interested in.
Yeah.
Justin Bieber.
Hmm. Though it might be too easy to group 16-year-olds, no? And it might be, isn't there a way maybe to find out more about individual? I don't know. How does each individual 16-year-old distribute something? I guess maybe they do. So I don't know. I mean, I admit, I've hardly used Facebook. I always ignore requests for being on Facebook when they come in, but I love the idea of it. I just think that I don't know if I love the idea of it, but I don't know if I want to use it. Yeah. 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 I doubt it. Performance only made sense to me at a certain time. I don't think it makes sense now. I don't think it makes sense to the kind of. I don't think a notion of self is strong enough now. And it seems like exhibitionism to me. But I always hated that about performance. I never had the desire to kind of be a personality, you know. I don't know. I mean, to say satisfied, I'm not sure. I,
yeah, I don't think I could do anything other than architecture and design now, because I'm much more interested in making some combination between use spaces and spaces that might be upside down or inside out. Because I certainly don't think use is enough, but I certainly don't think turning things inside out and upside down are enough either. So the combination of function and a kind of swoon seems really important to me. But your question I think shows that you think I should have stayed in, I should have stayed with my penis. I'm glad I didn't. But, yeah.
Architecture and whatnot. It's not necessarily my forte, but
But you do, though. Everybody knows architecture.
Certainly.
Everybody's always in architecture.
Certainly.
You know, you don't have to. The great thing about architecture is you don't have to study it. You're in it every day. There's nothing you do that isn't part of architecture.
Absolutely. No question. My question for you, though, is you talk about you and your firm consider obviously a lot about, as I'm assuming a lot of architecture design does, the body moving through that space, or how, for you in particular, how the landscape, how you can showcase the landscape affecting the situation that the viewer participant has in that. So I'm wondering what is success? Do you revisit those places after? Do you see the sort of, because I see the design and it's
some
like people hanging out and, does that happen, or do they kind of, it doesn't happen? You know, do people really engage with that? Do they understand the difference between that one with the kind of like rivers through it, sitting here versus sitting here? Is there that recognition of difference?
I don't know if I know.
I mean
I've gotten some clues. When the Graz project, the island project, I mean, it's not really an island. I mean, what I hate about that project is it has bridges. You know, islands aren't supposed to have bridges, but you know, at first we tried to make a passageway through the water, but then we realized that the water is most often about a foot or a foot and a half deep, so we couldn't do that because people would have to crawl, and the last thing I want people to do is crawl. When the project first opened in Graz, I had become pretty convinced that our audience, or not audience, I'm sorry I use that word, because I don't want to have an audience, I want to have inhabitants, users, et cetera, participants. I hope they're not just, you know, outside looking in on something we're doing. I've been convinced that we appeal to younger people, but we totally lose older people. You know? But when the island first opened, even before there was a cafe, people tended to take walks on the island, and especially older people, and I was really surprised because. And again, you know, I speak very, very little German, and older Germans don't speak much English. But it was kind of significant that this older couple was in the bowl part of the island, and then they looked up and saw the dome part, and they started to laugh, and I started to think, it seems like when people laugh, they get something. I mean, I always think that a laughter is a
laughter is a revelation of a second thought. You know, you've changed your mind. But I don't really know if it's true. I mean, what I do know is that that during that time, the local pastry shop made a little pastry called the Acconci Island. And it kind of looked like that. So it seemed to be, you know, it seemed to in some way, but, you know, but that was when it first opened in 2003. Now many years have passed. But recently, I mean, the kind of strange but interesting thing about the island is that it was built in 2003, when Graz was the European cultural capital, that year. So it was supervised by an organization called Graz 2003. But then it went out of existence in 2004. So it really hasn't been taken care of. It hasn't been maintained. Yet the cafe still exists, and they rent it from the city. But recently, there's been this newspaper campaign from people saying that we have to renovate the island. The island is falling apart. So I don't know. Does that mean they use it and want it? I hope it does.
But, yeah, I guess, that was my question, is kind of like
what, if you even care about, like, a kind of success in these projects, or if you do, like, what that looks like, you know? Is it just that the space is somehow altered and it has a kind of longevity through people wanting to upkeep it, maybe?
I mean, I wish we could change it. I wish we could change it every few years. Mm-hmm. Yeah. But I don't know if we can do that. I mean, it's not that we can't do that, but we would have to pay for it, and we're not very moneyed people. We might do a lot of stuff, but we obviously keep going, but we're not, most of the way we keep going is not through our design projects, but an occasional sale of some old art project. A lot of installations that I did, almost every installation I did in the 70s were destroyed at the time, because nobody believed that these were saleable. They thought they were window dressing, window dressing for galleries, so that a gallery would be drawn, so that people would be drawn into the gallery, and then they would buy a Rauschenberg or John's in the back room. We possibly, I don't know. I don't know if we can really survive just by means of old art installations. If we had a, I don't know, I have a very hard time being with the gallery, so it's very difficult for me to want to do that, yet at the same time, we certainly can't do that ourselves. But I don't know, also thinking, is there something wrong that we don't make money off the stuff we do? Are we like helpless children? We kind of are. thank you. Thank you.